It's time for the Access of Easy podcast, the weekly technology digest that keeps you ahead of the curve. Brought to you by EasyDNS.com.
Welcome back, everybody, to another episode of Access of Easy. This is number 312. This is, of course, the podcast sidekick to the weekly newsletter over on EasyDNS. You can sign up for that newsletter, accessofeasy.com. When you sign up, I think you get a little bit of a discount on your next round of stuff with EasyDNS, which you can't beat. This comes out every week on Friday. Yeah, it's fantastic. Every week on Friday, you can listen to us. You can read the newsletter. Little A, little B, Len and I offer some commentary. We come from the Bitcoin space, and we are happy to share our thoughts on all these different things. Lots going on this week, Len. Interesting stories. How are you doing today, buddy?
Well, I'm great, Joey. You know what? I just was thinking as you're rhyming off the intro, the before show, we had some good banter before the show and before recording this. That would have been awesome to record. Anyways, everything's good. It's rainy and everything around here, but I'm going to play some golf on Saturday. Maybe tomorrow, too. I'm going to try to get out there. If anyone wants to join me, let me know. Yeah, how are things over there, Joey?
Busy. Finished all the legal and whatnot for our new house today. My house is empty. Much to my wife's chagrin, I have only this Mac behind me and this laptop in front of me left out. So I'm going to probably start getting those in boxes tonight. And on Sunday when we get back, we will be getting going, man. We're ready to get out there to the new place. But anyway, let's talk about some quotes, Len. Last week's quote.
You're driving downhill, aren't you? Because you are kind of at the top of a mountain, you're going to go.
Yes.
It's going to be an easy move. Put the car in neutral and just let it coast. You don't need need very much gas to do this. You could just leave
I'll think
it off.
About that. I should consider that actually. You got to save money anywhere you can these days, right?
Exactly. So,
last week's quote: "There is little difference in people, but that little difference makes a big difference. The little difference is attitude. The big difference is whether it is positive or negative." That was by W. Clement Stone and Veronica with a K. Got that one right. That's very well done, Veronica. Congratulations to you. And this week's quote: "A government that robs Peter to pay Paul can always depend on the support of Paul." That's a good quote. I don't know who that's by. You know the rules. No searching, no nonsense. Don't pervert the process. And of course, before we start, Len, I almost forgot. In addition to getting a prize for getting the quote right, you get a sort of a second place prize if you leave a review on iTunes and we see it. And we'll read it on the show if you have time to do that. So we appreciate everyone listening, watching. And
that's
with that,
I like that quote. I don't know.
I think it's good too. With that, Len, we got how many stories today? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So let's hit the ground here.
Yeah, let's start with the UN and the United Nations. They're building what is termed a digital army. I love that term. And it's to combat disinformation and online hate speech. I guess the shadowy supercoder's name was taken, so they had to go with number 2 on that list. The army is going to consist of volunteers from around the world who are trained or who will be trained and report on harmful content. Man, volunteers. Come on, man. Think about it. I did some research. The UN's budget, annual budget, is over $3 billion. How much they sent to Ukraine? I mean, it's just a small number in comparison to $3 billion, but still, it's a lot of money in my eyes. I think they could have spared a few bucks rather than relying on these volunteers to do the job fighting on the cyber front. But anyways, these volunteers, not only are they going to be paid nothing, but they also have to be fluent in 2 different languages. So you have to have some skills here. You have to have some tangibles you have to bring to the table, but you're going to get paid nothing in return. The UN, they believe that this army is necessary to address the growing problem of online abuse and misinformation. Wow, so the UN, they believe that this has potential benefits, but they also acknowledge there could be some risks as well. So on one hand, the army could make it that the internet is a safer place by removing harmful content and by promoting positive dialogue. Very nice. On the other hand, they are concerned that the army could be used to censor legitimate information or legitimate speech and could suppress dissent. So there's 2 things going on here. Who knows what's going to really happen in the end? I know what reality is. So imagine having these very same soldiers you train, they go rogue. And if that ever happens, it might be time to call in a digital aid team to suppress them. The UN, they argue that the digital army is, of course, necessary, and it's a tool that they need to address the challenges of the digital age. Who would have thought this? However, it is important to be aware of the potential risks And hopefully they could use the army in a responsible way. But if I had to guess, probably not. They will be deploying this as they need to make their agenda, to improve on that and to push whatever narrative they want, which, you know what, this is par for the course these days. And this is another example of controlling the narrative.
Just a good content story. Hey, like the farm for content just never stops producing crops over at the United Nations. The one thing that sticks out to me in this whole story is that the UN is calling misinformation deadly, and they're raising an army, digital army, of course, for now anyway, to combat deadly misinformation. I'm not like, I'm trying to find the words here. I'm not 100% sure that it's the misinformation that's deadly. I think it actually may be the stuff that gets through the misinformation filter to the rest of us as true that is more likely to be deadly. I think recently of mandated medical intervention in many first world countries that caused a lot of grief to a lot of young men, some others as well. And I'm concerned because on top of that, the United Nations, Len, if you look up United Nations and scandal, you're going to see all manner of things from raping and pillaging villages to stealing money to upsetting elected governments to military invitations where they're, or military, I should say, interventions where they've not been welcome, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Of course, the UN also huge, huge part to play in all these unelected policy think tanks that just always seem to be successful when it comes down to whether or not elected officials embrace the policy. I hate this story, but it's nothing new, right? It's nothing new. We see this stuff out all the time. Don't forget in Bitcoin, another good example of this, like the FATF legislation about basically money transmitters and carrying money overseas or carrying money across borders as well. Everything is a fight with these guys because anything that gives you an opportunity to be a sovereign individual, a sovereign person, and live life on your terms is detrimental to these causes. They need groupthink to be successful in their causes, whether it's this idea that we have to abandon fossil fuels and embrace carbon reduction at any cost immediately, or whether it's, well, we don't want people to be able to transfer their wealth overseas or across borders, or you can name your cause. There's hundreds of them at this point, especially over the last 3 or 4 years. The thing I would also mention is that, man, this is an announcement of a digital army. I can't imagine this is not already happening, though. Like this might be the first public-facing statement of this sort. But I mean, if you look at the way these guys do their business, I don't think this is new. Do you think this? I don't think this is new. It can't be new. Look at the way they act. Like they do this all over the place.
Well, I mean, maybe the UN, I'm not going to speak with them, but the United States government, for instance, the NSA, like, come on, they've been doing this for, we could assume they've been doing this for a very long time.
What do you mean? There's a story here every week about how the government, there's a story in here this week about the government doing this with TikTok. Like, it's not like it's not up for debate. This has been going on. It's not the first time. It won't be the last. You got to take care of your privacy, man. And, like you always say, that's the most important thing these days.
Well, let's talk about more privacy, because we could talk about Australia, and they have proposed an online safety bill. And this is a dangerous step forward towards Soviet style censorship. The bill would give the government sweeping powers to censor online content, including the ability to remove content that is deemed to be false and misleading.
Insane. It's the same thing. It's the same thing.
Exactly. And so instead of the UN doing it, now it's the Australian government using something called the Online Safety Bill. So they're wrapping it in this nice little bow and everything to make it appear much different, but nothing to see here. Of course, they won't use this power to these powers and abuse it. Nah, they'll do it for a good cause. The bill would create a new government agency, the E-Safety Commissioner. And this would be responsible for enforcing the law. Oh my God. So the argument against the bill is that it is so broad and that it could be used to censor legitimate speech, such as criticism of the government or reporting on important information. The bill could be used to limit discussion about even such like scientific research that the government disagrees with. So if you want to bring some facts that is against the government narrative, they're going to put that to the back burner. Additionally, the bill would create a system of government approved truths. This would obviously stifle debate And this is a step in the wrong direction. So the bill would also give the e-safety commissioner the power to block websites and also social media accounts. This is going not a step too far. That's a leap too far. And obviously, free speech advocates out there, they're against this. They're saying that the online safety bill is a threat to freedom of speech and democracy in Australia. Now, Australia seems to have been trending in the wrong direction for a number of years. We've all seen what happened a few years ago when they decided to close things down, created these camps for these people that were not doing that well physically or refused to get anything pumped in their body. So Australia, they seem to have a recent history of doing crap like this more and more over. So if I was living there or considering to move there, I would consider to go somewhere else, because the way things are progressing over there, like, I'm just looking at this, like, let's be perfectly honest. If they're going to take steps like this, they're going to be monitoring everything. And if you want to say something, your free speech could be stifled. Not only that, closing of accounts, social media accounts, you could be left in the dark ages and you'd be left using your ham radio or CB radio just to talk to your friends. That's not the way to go. But this is Australia and this is 2023.
In communist prison colony Australia, okay, they have decided that they are just mailing it in on all the things that make you a democratic country. They've done obviously all the things you mentioned over the last 3 years we won't get into here in the interest of preserving the channel's integrity. But if you look at this whole story, like blocking websites, Len, blocking websites, that, you know what that, like, you know how they could do that? Like the amount of cooperation they would need from like mobile carriers, from VPN providers, from, I don't know, all manner of things, probably device manufacturers at some level. Like, this is insane to me. I thought the last story was bad. This one is way worse. The only saving grace is that Australia, you know, is probably going to fail as a state pretty soon, because they're the only country who's done worse with managing a real estate bubble than Canada has. There's a great presentation, I think I've shared it with you before, of a fellow who did a talk at an Australian, I believe it's a think tank dinner, about a year ago. I want to say about a year ago, maybe a little less than that, where he compares Canada to Australia, and Australia is like, you know, N times worse than we are over here. And so the only saving grace in this whole thing is that this will fail, because Australia is likely at some point to like default or fail, which is, you know, unfortunately, I think the best outcome if this is the direction they're going. I can't believe you said they seem to have been going the wrong direction over the last few years. Like, yeah, man, they seem to have been going that way. You're right.
I don't want the great firewall of Australia to encompass me. So that's why I'm trying to leave this very open-ended. So if they want to go after me, at least I wasn't direct in my approach and I left a little bit open there, and hopefully they leave the firewall slightly
open. These guys are supposed to be, like, my wife watches a lot of garbage TV. It's like her thing at nighttime. She's either reading or watching garbage TV. And one of the shows she watches is this show called Below Deck. And it's all these Australian, like, early 30s, they're probably around my age actually, early to mid 30s or maybe mid 20s, and they work on these like luxury yachts for the summer, and they all seem so cool and relaxed and chill, as the kids say. And then I see stories like this and I think, how is this such a stark contrast between this legislation and the way these kids are on this boat, and like what I see from like social media and the Australian people I interact with on Twitter. Who's asking for these things? And I mean, this is the case in other places too, but Australia is sort of world famous for its laid back attitudes. I guess not so much anymore. It's not the, you know, these are not the things like I keep hearing about and seeing online, but this is like a very, very stark contrast to that. I continue to be surprised by their decline.
That's the stuff that comes out of the country. So the e-video commissioner that's been approving stuff like that could actually be exported from their shores. That's what we could see, but who knows what's actually going on over there.
Yeah, it's approved content.
So let's keep moving on. And we're getting now a number of reports about a warning from ICANN. We talked about ICANN before, and that's the Internet Corporation for Assigned Names and Numbers. And this warning is about the United Nations Global Digital Compact. The United Nations, two times in the same day
all just the same story with different headlines?
What the heck is going on?
You're not allowed to do what you want on the internet. We're going to tell you what you can do, and you're going to effing like it too, okay?
Well, I'm going to love it, I'll tell you that much. So the UN's Global Digital Compact, that's the GDC, they have proposed an international agreement that aims to promote what they call a free, open, and secure internet. I guess it's all in the eyes of the beholder. ICANN is concerned that the GDC would exclude technical experts from the discussion about the future of internet governance. So you're taking away the right people in there to discuss what's very important to us. The GDC's proposed governance model would create three stakeholder groups. And one is governments, second is private sector, and the third is civil society. And there's no mention of the inclusion of the digital army members. So maybe they're the fourth ones that just not written here. But anyways, ICANN argues that technical experts play a vital role in ensuring stability and security of the internet. I could understand their point of view. They argue that technical experts are essential to developing solutions to migrating challenges such as cybersecurity and content moderation. Unreal. So ICANN, they're calling out the UN to reconsider the GDC proposal. The proposed governance model, and they believe that the GDC should include technical experts as a distinct voice in the internet governance. But ICANN is not the only organization out there that's trying to hold them to task. There's other organizations such as the Internet Society and the World Wide Web Consortium. They have also expressed concerns about the GDC's proposed governance model, something which could be very scary if they go ahead with this. This is all just a matter of talk right now. Nothing is concluded or has been made permanent yet, but the fact that they're talking about this, three very similar stories in a row, like just about controlling the narrative. This is a strikeout if you ask me.
Okay, let's, from now on, we're gonna do a test with these stories. Okay, when someone wants to govern what you say, think, and who can contribute to those things, we're gonna do the Reddit r/relationships or relationship advice test. Relationship advice is a subreddit I go to sometimes as a guilty pleasure to see what kind of conundrums people have been gaslit into in terms of their, you know, marriages and other relationships they may have with the opposite sex or the same sex. I'm not judging.
Or no sex. Yeah. You never know.
Sexless. Actually, there's a number of sexless relationships on there in many different ways. So if you put this on relationship advice, okay, let's just kind of reframe this. If the UN is the boyfriend, okay, and ICANN is the girlfriend, and the girlfriend makes the post and says, my boyfriend won't let me see or read the things I want to see or read, and also won't let me explain to him with other people who have things at stake in this whole relationship, why this is a bad idea, what should I do? The relationship advice subreddit would cry out in unison, a harmonious heavenly choir. Dump the guy, pack your stuff in the middle of the night, and GTFO. This is what these people should do, right? Like, ICANN is trying to do something here that makes sense. They want to involve other stakeholders. The UN keeps on using the term technical experts as if that means anything, as if technical or experts means anything these days. Again, not to draw on the experiences of the last 3 years, but really these are, you know, fresh in our memories all over the modern world. What reason, I should say, do I have to give any leeway, any leash at all, any benefit of the doubt to the United Nations in this instance? What rationale do I have? I've been fooled here, buddy. It doesn't pass the relationship advice test. It doesn't pass the what have you done for me lately test. What test does it pass? Why should anyone adhere to this? This is why internet freedom, in my opinion, is the most important issue of the next century, because everyone is going to start getting on this thing, including people from the third world who are not connected at the same rate that we are here in the first world. And they're going to be catching up on a lot of things that I think they may not really know the full picture on. Like, what kind of guy is Bill Gates? How about all those malaria tents? All that kind of stuff, right? How much contraception should you be using? All these different things, you know? Is the guy riding around my neighborhood with a gold machine gun in a chopped off Jeep actually the leader of the country? These things are important, that, and they're not really widely available now. And no one should be able to govern what information is out there, because one day it benefits you, another day it benefits somebody else. The point is that it's got to be equal at all times. And so we're kind of laughing at these stories because they're so similar this week, but this is nuts, man. It's so important to have private browsing and free internet, free access to information. And it seems like we're going the wrong direction at every turn. And by the way, when anyone says the United Nations, what they're really saying is the United States. Like, the United States is the United Nations. I don't know if anyone else needs to hear that. Like, this is where they get all their money. It's where they get all their military might. It's where they get all their influence. It's not from Macron. It's not from Merkel or whoever's in Germany now. It's from the United States. And that's it. So this is what the United States wants. You got to ask yourself why they want that, I think, at some point, you know, for the beacon of democracy, at least in their eyes, to be asking for these sorts of policy changes and, quote unquote, improvements to the open internet. You got to ask yourself why, if you haven't already.
But do you, I mean, one way to judge success is how many flags you have flying. And typically, like, you look at, well, let's look at the UN. They have many flags outside their New York compound. And that's a, and, you know, like, look at other areas that they're flying all these new flags almost by the day with all these different things on it.
I got a couple neighbors who probably have a security council veto if we're going by flag count.
There you go. When you have a lot of flags, unique flags, different flags, that shows success. And to me, that's trust. And I'm going to open up the pocketbook and start donating. I want to see those volunteers.
When are you giving your first trillion? Are you giving your first trillion this year or next year?
I'll give them my Zimbabwe trillion. I have no problems about that. So once the Canadian dollar gets devalued enough, I'll give them that as well. Let's move on.
Off the rails here.
Let's talk about a new variant of the XLoader malware. XLoader. Nothing spectacular. Two and a half at best out of five. It's kind of old school, but not unique enough, and not doesn't have enough pizzazz. It looks like an early 90s thing, but nothing great. Anyways, the XLoader malware has been discovered to target macOS devices. So that device behind you, Joey, you gotta take a careful
Look out.
Unplug that guy. So we'll be discussing. So the malware is disguised as an office productivity app called OfficeNote. So take note of this, macOS users. OfficeNote, say no to that. And this is being used as a way to distribute a variety of methods, including email attachments, malicious websites, and even social media posts. So once the XLoader is installed on a macOS device, it could steal the sensitive information. We talk about all the nasty stuff, including login credentials for emails, banking, social media accounts, credit card numbers that are stored in your computer, browser history, and worse, keystrokes. So this malware can be used to install other malware on a victim computer to take control of the device remotely. So it's absolutely nuts. So SentinelOne, a cybersecurity firm, they first reported on the new XLoader variant on August 15th. This thing is a very recent discovery. The firm has since released a blog post with more information about the malware. And they say SentinelOne researchers recommend that macOS users take the following steps to protect themselves from XLoader. Be careful about opening email attachments from unknown senders. People should always do this. Only download apps from trusted source. Again, people should always do this. Keep your macOS software up to date. I don't want to sound like a broken record here, but again, people should always do this. And use a reputable antivirus program? What the heck? If you believe that your macOS device was infected with an XLoader, you should immediately disconnect it and keep it offline from the internet and scan it with a reputable antivirus program. This is according to the good people over there. And after reading this, I think John McAfee would be rolling in his grave or laughing out loud. Either one, after hearing the suggestion, given the fact that do anybody use an antivirus program these days? Does anybody trust them? They seem to carry more viruses and just slow down their system. Anyways, yeah, so be very careful if you're using a macOS device. I gave you a number of suggestions which could protect you, but those suggestions should apply to any software, any operating system, any device. Don't do that crap. You're only asking for problems if you do.
Agreed. I'll note, as a Mac user and as an iPhone user, like I'm into the ecosystem. I got to be honest with you, I really like the ecosystem. It's very simple to use. And one of the reasons it's simple to use is that if you need an app for your Mac or for your phone, you just go to the App Store. The App Store does the work for you most of the time. And then, you know, as is noted in the article here, in the photo, the distributor, the app creator, is not listed as Microsoft. And so, like, you have to look for these things. This is another kind of indicator, red flag you can look for when you're downloading something. It's not that hard to do this. But again, Len, you and I talk about this every week. These things are not targeting guys like you and me. They're targeting, you know, maybe grandma and grandpa or, you know, I don't know. I feel like sometimes I'm still 20 because I was going to say, like, maybe it's targeting, like, the middle-aged the middle-aged people who have computers, but that's pretty much you and me. So I don't really know who's downloading this app, because certainly you and I are not downloading it. I'm not really clear on who the target is, but obviously it's hurting people. So be aware.
And I would suggest, if you even want to like download stuff and it's not from a reputable source, like spin up something called Tails Linux. Like I have it loaded up on this USB. I could load it up, and what it is a standalone device, standalone IO operating system, and you can do whatever you want with it. And when you turn the computer off, it deletes everything. And so if you really want to test something out without really exposing too much, check out something like Tails OS, and it gives you opportunities to test things out without exposing too much. So there are opportunities if you want to really be a vigilante and explore things on the internet that should normally not be explored. And the last article here is, well, it's a report on a leaked draft agreement between TikTok and the Committee on Foreign Investment in the United States, CFIUS. And the agreement, which was dated the summer of 2022, would have given the committee unprecedented access to TikTok's data and operations. And specifically, the agreement would have allowed the committee to examine TikTok's U.S. facility records and servers with minimal prior notice. And I wonder if this also leads to examining the CCP headquarters, which TikTok seems to be attached to at the hip. It would also allow them to veto any hiring of executives involved with leading TikTok U.S. data security organization. That's a very powerful tool right there, vetoing any hires. It would also allow them to block changes to the app's terms of service in the U.S. and order the company to subject itself to various audits, all on TikTok's dime. An agreement would have required TikTok to create a new executive security committee that would operate in secrecy from ByteDance. And the committee would be responsible for making decisions about TikTok's data security and would have the power to veto any decisions made by TikTok management. That's a lot of power. And the draft agreement obviously was never finalized, but it's unclear whether these two parties are still negotiating. But it goes to show you that it provides a glimpse of what's going on and the lengths the U.S. government wants to go and how much power they want to, in terms of what they say, protecting its citizens for national security interests. And privacy implications, again, it's highlighted in this agreement. It's very, very important. Some critics have argued that the agreement would give the committee too much access to TikTok's data, and it would be able to be used to spy on American users. And TikTok obviously denies this claim, and they themselves want to retain the exclusive access to spying on American users. But the agreement has raised concerns about the potential for government surveillance. And this has always been a case for any time you see these type of overreach agreements. And this is another reminder that the tensions between national security and privacy in the digital age, they're very important for governments because they need this. They want this. It's a good way to control us. It's a good way to control the narrative. And they could do it with the under the guise of national security, and it's best for individual privacy and all this garbage. But the reality is, this type of thing is extreme overreach. I'm not a fan of TikTok, but handing off all the keys to the U.S. government, it's exchanging one enemy for another, in my opinion, and it's a step in the wrong direction. But you know what? These are things that are outside my control, and I don't use TikTok. So I think everybody out there should also follow my steps with that. Don't use that crappy service.
I've never had TikTok on my phone. I will never have it. My wife does not have it either. I'll just say this. You could sum this whole article up in really one or two sentences, right? Like, TikTok was villainized for, quote unquote, spying on people. And now that they're coming to the US, the US government is saying, okay, you have to spy on our citizens then, and we get to see what the data looks like. Do I have that right? Like, what's going on here, Len? What is happening? Why does anyone trust anything that any of these companies or governments do? Everyone is looking at your data. You have to assume that every swipe on your phone, someone gets a look at it. It's not anonymized. It's not thrown into a pile for, quote unquote, user experience improvements. It's got your name on it, your IP address, your device ID. They know what you're doing. They know when you're doing it. And I'm looking at the comments here of this article just to see what the NPC majority is saying. And everyone is saying, oh, this is pretty standard. Or the US does this with everything. It's standard auditing practices. Are you stupid, man? Just because it's standard doesn't mean it's good. If you find out something like this is standard, you should be upset about it. Not go, oh, well, it's just another drop in the ocean here. No, man. This is what's going on in every facet of your life. There's cameras when you walk out of your house on your neighbor's doorbell. There's red light cameras that capture your face. Your cell phone's got a camera. Everyone is looking at you. Everyone's tracking you. Everything is digital. You got to get out of that somehow. And the way to do that is to be secure about the things you do, the apps you use, and when you use them, VPNs, other sort of support services and systems, FOSS software. Len's got a phone that barely even works. He's so worried about privacy. Like, all this stuff is important as time goes on. I got to tell you, Len, like, the more we do the show, this is like, what, the probably 20th time we've done this, something like that. I constantly am thinking about getting like a Pixel 7 next time they're on sale, or like whatever the newest Pixel is, and just going full de-Google. What's the name of that operating system everybody has in the Bitcoin world?
Graphene OS.
Graphene, yeah, going graphene and using that as my daily driver instead, and just using my iPhone as a camera, honestly. Because I don't use Instagram anymore. I just use Twitter and whatever else. But yeah, scary times, man. Everyone's against you and there's nothing you can do about it. So on that,
for you to even consider, holy cow, this is huge. And why would you keep that just as a camera? I mean, the camera on the newer phones, the Pixel 7 is pretty good. And it's not like I have graphene. It doesn't function as a camera. It has the same functionality. You'd be surprised at how well it functions as a daily driver. You could use it exactly the same as any Google phone if you want to, but you're going to give up a heck of a lot. Or if you want to limit a lot of the Google apps on it and still retain a lot of functionality, you can do that. You'd be surprised at how well it functions. It locks the door. It's hardened. And it ensures that you have more control over your privacy than you would any other device. But, and still in the end, the hardware, you're not 100% sure that it is fail-safe. The modem itself is not open source. And it's a very powerful tool inside every phone. And because that's not open source, that information could be intercepted at any time. So just because you're running graphene doesn't mean you're perfectly safe. There's always a crack somewhere. And that's one crack that I know of for sure. There could be more.
Yeah, I got to look into it. Maybe after this, I'll watch a couple of YouTube videos or something. I got nothing else to do tonight. So anyway, that's it, everybody. Thanks for tuning in. Access of Easy. We'll see you next week, same time, same place. Until then, subscribe, like, leave a review, and take care of yourselves.
Yeah, take care.